Is remote work a sustainable model? Moe Vela is Chief Transparency Officer of Transparent Business. Moe, welcome.
Thank you so much for having me, Robert. It's a pleasure to be with you.
Moe, Netflix CEO Reed Hastings recently was quoted as saying that working from home has, quote, no positives, unquote. What do you say to that?
Well, let me first start by saying I admire and I respect Mr. Hastings' incredible success in his whole career, but I could not disagree with him more on this particular matter. I'm in a state of shock, to be honest with you, that he would have made such a bold and erroneous statement, Robert.
Mm-hmm. Well, let's talk about why, in your opinion, is erroneous. Let me run down some of what I consider to be, or what I'm told are the arguments against working from home, and I'd like to hear your comments on them. For instance, and I think this is one of Reed Hastings' points, the lack of ability to collaborate one-on-one together in the same space, the lack of ability to bounce ideas off one another, to socialize. What do you say to that?
Well, first of all, if you and I are socializing right now.
Here we are.
And if you and I wanted to exchange and brainstorm and bounce ideas off of each other, I don't need to be in the same room with you to do that. I'm a creative type guy. I actually am co-owner of a production company. I don't need to be in the same room with you. For years, I've been talking to other producers on the other side of the world.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
I don't fly to Italy just to discuss a creative idea, for God's sake. So I just don't understand where Mr. Hastings is coming from. Look, I think old habits are hard to break, Robert.
Yeah.
And I think that we've all gotten so accustomed. Look, I'm not going to deny a couple of things. I don't deny that there is a sense of security, if you will, for a comfort, maybe an enhanced sense of connectivity when you are in person with another human being. I'm not denying any of that. I'm a very passionate Latino who happens to be a member of the LGBTQ community. So I've got a double whammy of passion and wanting to be with people. Mm-hmm. So I don't deny that. But if there's anything I've learned about myself and others these last 6 months, is that we can connect just like you and I are right now, and I can feel that. I can feel emotion through a video conference. I have felt it hundreds of times the last 6 months. I have had creative juices. I have had creative energy. I have nothing, not one of those things has been lacking in the ability to do it over a video conferencing call. So I don't buy it.
Need I point out the irony of the theoretical closeness of people in the same room when all the people around the table are looking at their phones? So are they really together in the same place?
They're not even
at all.
To your point, they're not even really there, right?
Right, right.
90% of the time they're texting or they even have their laptop in front of them or whatever you call the new little square thing, you know.
Yeah, exactly. Well, let me talk about the issue of meetings, which are both necessary and a scourge of the business world, depending on where they're conducted. I'm not clear on whether remote work versus work on a work site leads to more or less meetings. There's plenty of meetings when you're actually in an office, but then also there's been an awful lot of meetings with people remotely now, and I don't know why that would be if bosses are looking to get a better fix on what their employees are doing. What do you think where do you stand on the meeting issue and how that relates to working from home?
I think that there are probably more meetings, but that's anecdotal.
Mm-hmm.
And I'll tell you why I think that there are. I think that we might be overcompensating, to your point, just a little bit to try to maintain that sense of connectivity.
Mm-hmm.
Because I think communication is taking on a very enhanced role as we move to this remote workforce model. And so in enhancing our communication, I think meetings tend to make us feel like that we're checking off that box.
Yeah.
Because if I have a Zoom meeting or even a phone call meeting, a conference call meeting or anything of the sort, I have to say I hang up or I shut down the Zoom call or the Skype call whatever it is. And I do feel like, oh, okay, I did it. I feel good about it, right? Mm-hmm. So I think we might be overcompensating. That's just me. That's just my humble opinion.
Okay. What about the employer view that, you know, they get a little nervous. They're not sure just what it is you're doing at home. And they're not sure whether you're working up to your highest level of productivity because they're not looking over your shoulder all the time. Right. What do you say to a boss about that?
Well, first of all, in a remote workforce model, technology is our best friend. It's almost as if the technology universe and the technology gods were preparing us for this pandemic, Robert. Think about mm-hmm. it. All of these softwares have been created, all of these apps, all of these solutions and tools are now at our beck and call. You and I are utilizing Zoom right now. That was created not for this pandemic, but my God, it was perfectly prepared for
sure,
us.
Sure came in handy, didn't it? Yeah.
Continue mm-hmm. to conduct business. We could continue to get to know one another. The beauty is whether it's keeping your workforce cohesion in place through Slack and other things. And then, of course, at Transparent Business, where I'm on the board and I'm Chief Transparency Officer, we arguably have the most comprehensive software to manage and coordinate remote workforces. So we have a software that does it, and we do it without invading an employee's privacy. Unfortunately, a lot of our competitors, Robert, use cameras and spyware and such to mm-hmm. where they invade an employee's privacy. We're really proud we don't do that, and we have some competitors who don't do that as well.
Okay, so though that type of thing is definitely not the answer. Now, of course, there's the obvious question about, and we have all been on Zoom calls where we heard dogs and children in the background and doors slamming and things like that, which leads to the question, certainly there are distractions at home. They take you away from your focus on work. I mean, I don't know, I'm not saying I believe that, but I'm saying that's definitely a belief. What do you think about that?
Well, the irony of the whole thing is every study I have seen, and I have been looking at every piece of research I can get my hands on. We don't have a ton of research yet in this pandemic on work on remote workforce, but mm-hmm. there were many studies done before. All of them consistently show that workers who work in a remote workforce setting are much more productive than they are in a traditional work environment, which is completely counter to what you're saying and what we all, I think, were assuming was going to happen, right?
Yeah.
There are distractions. To your point, you're absolutely spot on. There are distractions, especially when our children can't go to school, right? And that's adding a complexity to the matter. Mm-hmm. But let's just assume they're back in school, right? There's still distractions. The dog needs to go out. Right. As you point out, the mailman knocks on the door or a delivery arrives or whatever it is. Mm-hmm. There are distractions. But the incredible part is when we are in the zone and working from home, what the studies show is you're in the zone like you're like not the same way you are at a traditional work environment.
Yeah.
Because there are also distractions. Right. The
sure.
break. The coffee break, let me go down the street and grab a Starbucks, whatever those distractions are. People, your colleagues come in, poke their head in your door, right?
Mm-hmm.
So
mm-hmm.
believe it or not, all studies show that remote workers are much higher producers.
Yeah, I would guess that would depend in part on how you're set up at home. If you're working on your kitchen table, that's one thing. If you have a discrete or separate office or a space in your home that you can devote to your office, I would think that would focus you and make you more productive and less distracted.
No doubt about it. And one of the tips and pieces of advice I've been giving now for, in dozens and dozens of these interviews across the country, is that you've got to distinguish between personal space and workspace, not just for the reason that you just alluded to, but also for your mental health. Mm-hmm. It's very important to distinguish and draw a line so that you're not burning the candle at both ends, because that'll end up getting you into a burnout situation or isolationism, anxiety, some stress. So I really hit hard on my advice on distinguishing between personal space and workspace, and also to engage in self-care, whatever that means to you. It could be reading a book, it could be walking, yoga, whatever, gardening, crafting. working on your hobbies, but you've got to engage in self-care, Robert, and you have to distinguish between, okay, my kitchen table is both my desk, and in my case, it is. I eat here, and I also work here. Mm-hmm. I clear it out, and I distinguish when I'm going to eat dinner here. I don't want my computer,
so
my
same
laptop.
Space, but you're able to draw a line. Interesting.
Absolutely.
Even though it's the same space. But isn't it the case, though, that some people are more temperamentally suited to working from home and others are better suited to working in an office environment?
There's no doubt about that. And I think, you know, this is the beauty of human dynamics, right? And when we're dealing with human beings, we're all, frankly, we're also uniquely individual. And so, yes, temperament is a part of it. And I think my projection and prediction has been consistently that I believe most major companies are going to start after this pandemic will be offering a hybrid of opportunity. I do believe that many of them, you can hear Slack and Facebook and Google and many of them already announcing they will remain partially or wholly remote. But yeah. I think ultimately you're going to be offering a good employer will make it part of their employee benefit package. I have been advocating for this for a while now, that this is another way to attract talent. And that, talking about talent, a remote workforce model allows you now to attract talent anywhere in the globe.
Yeah, and that will become especially important once the economy recovers. We get back to where we were before with 3% unemployment. You're going to need every carrot you can dangle in front of prospective workers in order to get them to join your company. So
that's right, and this is a good one to dangle, Robert. I have been saying that for a while.
Certainly sounds like it. Well, some possible permanent changes in the way that companies work going forward, and the acceptance of the wisdom and the attractiveness of working from home, remote work. Moe Vela of Transparent Business, thanks for bringing all this to light for us. I really appreciate your speaking with us today. Thanks a lot.
It's a pleasure to be with you, and thanks for having me, Robert, and stay well and healthy.
You as well.